Oh, special treat. Our youth are going to be reporting on their summer mission trip that they took this summer and some of the activities that they did for that. And our RLC Praise Band will be leading all of our music today. So that's exciting alone. We are in that transition from the summer months into the fall, so a lot of things going on here in the next couple of weeks. Next weekend, Labor Day weekend, there's no Monday night service on those big holidays, those federal holidays. Everybody's just too busy recovering from Labor Day, apparently. So only church on Sunday morning next week, regular times. Confirmation parents meeting comes up quickly after that, after Labor Day on September 4th, and then Rally Day on September 8th with our Sunday school startup right after that. So again, a lot of stuff happening right now and a lot of changes and things get gearing and going back together as well. Bernie and Bonnie Elliott are downstairs. They are celebrating their 50th wedding anniversary, and they invite all of you to join them in that celebration as well. Do we have any other anniversaries we're celebrating right now? Either last week or the week coming, any anniversaries? How about birthdays? What do we got going for birthdays? Yours? That means your brother, too. Yeah, I figured that one out. On my own. Yeah. All right. Yeah. And Sadie warned me that they're taking their driver's test this week, right? So you can be a licensed driver by the end of the week? What?
Next week.
Next week. Well, either way, it's a scary thought. So hope things go well for both of you on that. So, all right, let's go to our Lord in prayer. Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. Much we need thy tender care. In thy pleasant pastures, feed us for our use. Thy folds prepare. Father, through your word and through the influence of other people, but mostly through the power of your Holy Spirit, you prepare us for your use. That you call us by the gospel and enlighten us with your gifts, sanctify and keep us in the true faith, so that we might preach and teach that gospel to others and share the love of Christ with all that we meet. Bless us through your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please stand, take a moment, greet those around you, and remain standing for opening hymn.
Thank you.
fool says in his heart, there is no God.
They are corrupt. They do wrong. There is none who does good.
Holy and gracious God, by the mercy of God, we are redeemed by Jesus Christ, and in Him we are forgiven. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by His authority, I forgive you all of your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
He who began this good work within you, bring it to completion on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. The peace of the Lord be with you. Our responsive psalm today is Psalm 14. The fool says in his heart, there is no God.
They are corrupt. They do wrong. There is none who does good.
The Lord looks down from heaven on the children of man to see if there is any who understand, who seek after God.
They have all turned aside.
No knowledge, all the evildoers who eat up my people as they eat bread and do not call upon the Lord. You would shame the plans of the poor, but the Lord is his refuge. When the Lord restores the fortunes of his people, please be seated.
The first reading is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 29, verses 11 to 19. And the vision of all this has become to you like the words of a book that is sealed. When men give it to one who can read, saying, "Read this," he says, "I cannot, for it is sealed." And when they give the book to one who cannot read, saying, "Read this," he says, "I cannot read." And the Lord said, "Because this people draw near with their mouth and honor me with their lips, while their hearts are far away from me, and their fear of me is in a commandment taught by men. Therefore, behold, I will again do wonderful things with this people, with wonder upon wonder, and the wisdom of their wise men shall perish, and the discernment of their discerning men shall be hidden. Ah, you who hide deep from the Lord your counsel, whose deeds are in the dark, and who say, 'Who sees us? Who knows us?' You turn things upside down. Shall the potter be regarded as the clay, that the thing made should say of its maker, 'He did not make me'? Or the thing formed say to him who formed it, 'He has no understanding'? Is it not yet a very little while until Lebanon shall be turned into a fruitful field, and the fruitful field shall be regarded as a forest? In that day the deaf shall hear the words of a book, and out of their gloom and darkness the eyes of the blind shall see. The meek shall obtain fresh joy in the Lord, and the poor among mankind shall exult in the Holy One of Israel." This is the word of the Lord. The epistle reading today is from 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 to 17. "You then, my child, be strengthened by the grace that is in Christ Jesus, and what you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to faithful men who will also be able to teach others also. Share in suffering as a good soldier of Christ Jesus. No soldier gets entangled in civilian pursuits, since his aim is to please the one who enlisted him. An athlete is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. It is the hardworking farmer who ought to have the first share of the crops. Think over what I say, for the Lord will give you understanding in everything. Remember Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, the offspring of David, as preached in my gospel, for which I am suffering, bound with chains as a criminal. But the word of God is not bound. Therefore, I endure everything for the sake of the elect, that they also may obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. The saying is trustworthy, for if we have died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we deny him, he will also deny us. If we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. Remind them of these things and charge them before God not to quarrel about words, which does no good, but only ruins the hearers. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, rightly handling the word of truth. But avoid irreverent babble, for it will lead people into more and more ungodliness, and their talk will spread like gangrene." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please stand for the gospel. Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 7th chapter. Now when the Pharisees gathered to him with some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem, they saw that some of his disciples ate with hands that were defiled, that is, unwashed. For the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they wash their hands properly, holding to the tradition of the elders. And when they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash. And there are many other traditions that they observe, such as the washing of cups and pots and copper vessels and dining couches. And the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, "Why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands?" And he said to them, Well did Isaiah prophesy of you hypocrites, as it is written, this people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. You leave the commandment of God and hold to the tradition of them. And he said to them, you have a fine way of rejecting the commandment of God in order to establish your tradition. For Moses said, honor your father and your mother, and whoever reviles father or mother must surely die. But you say, if a man tells his father or his mother, whatever you would have gained from me is Corban, that is, given to God, then you no longer permit him to do anything for his father or mother, thus making void the word of God by your tradition that you have handed down. And many such things you do. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord.
We confess our faith using the words of the apostles. I believe.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The unofficial LCMC youth gathering came to be held at Ironwood Springs Christian Ranch in Stuartville, Minnesota, orchestrated by two part-time youth directors, Kari Feldhaus of South Dakota and myself. We were joined by a group of 80-some students and leaders from all over the country, as far away as Texas and New Hampshire, for an unforgettable week at camp. A week that you simply cannot summarize in a two-minute summary, but I'll try. Kari and I made a great team with different and complementary gifts, and we were full of enthusiasm and love for our awesome students. We prioritized having solid theological content for the week, using the Bible, the catechism, prayer, song, and gospel preaching from numerous pastors and teachers. We also prioritized music, and the full RLC praise team led worship on opening night, and the band led for the duration of the week. The two theme songs that we had for the week are the ones you just heard here, The Plans, based on our theme verse, Jeremiah 29:11, and Called to Be, Mustard Seed, which speaks to plans that God has for each one of us in our lives. We had service projects throughout the week. They did service projects throughout the camp. They also packed gift bags for military families as part of Operation Welcome Home and presented them while singing God Bless America. There were speakers for every main session and small group breakouts. We had a surprise visit from Ironwood Springs founder Bob Barnwell, who shared his amazing testimony. Carlin Wardwell set up prayer stations based on our identity in Christ, and we sang songs around the campfire. We took a wagon ride into the woods for a chuck wagon supper, Q&A with a panel of leaders, and Squad Wars karaoke, which you'll see in the video. It's pretty epic. Recreation included zip lines, a giant slip and slide, and playing with farm animals. Pastor Scott from North Carolina got the whole camp engaged in the high-energy game of head, shoulders, knees, cup. Dan Antwine from Ingemokoboji and Pastor Caleb from Kerrville, Texas, pointed students to their true calling, to glorify God in all things. Every element of the camp was special and impactful. We read our Bibles, took selfies with Jumbo Jesus, and saw lives truly changed, both students and adults. Although we could see God clearly leading and making a way where there was no way throughout the entire planning process, as time went on, it became abundantly clear just how much he truly was involved. We watched other leaders rejoice over a troubled student who was transformed into a smiling teen by the end of the week. We had a group of students from South Dakota who was so inspired by our praise team that they led their very first youth-led praise and worship service using songs they learned at camp. There was honest lament and tears of joy. The plans being our theme for the summer couldn't have been more fitting, as initially our plans were to head to Des Moines for the youth gathering. And our speakers tied into the theme in all that they shared. For example, Tasha Hsu had that verse, Jeremiah 29:11, on her dorm wall in college because her plans in life were not to become a paraplegic for junior year of high school. My plans did not include losing my dad a couple of days before the gathering, but in all of these things, God was proven faithful and worthy of our praise. I want to thank the congregation of Rushford Lutheran for your support of this and all other youth programs. I wish that every single one of our students could attend these camps, retreats, mission trips, because you can just watch the seeds of faith that are planted in the church during Sunday school truly start to bloom and grow in settings like these. You then, my child, be strengthened by the grace that is in Christ Jesus, and what you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. Praise God for the students of our congregation who are being raised up to be leaders and will be able to teach others also. We have a little video, a recap video here to share, so watch and feel free to ask the kids after church about anything that you see on there. And then I'm going to bring them up to share about what they learned.
Hi, my name is Sadie. My favorite part of the camp was listening to Tasha Shu's story. It was really inspiring, and I learned a lot.
Hello, my name is Megan. My favorite part about the camp was kind of watching it fall into place and watching everybody come together and make it happen.
My name is Monica, and my favorite part was listening to all the speakers and the great messages, and then getting to meet a bunch of people and talking to people.
My name is Shelby, and my favorite part was probably the stations in the middle of the day and the service projects.
My name is Madison, and I really couldn't pick a favorite part because there were so many amazing moments, but I really love the music.
My name is Shannon, and I had a lot of favorite parts, and the one thing that I learned from this amazing trip and all these amazing speakers, and realizing that God's plans are not always what we think they're going to be, but being able to see the Kristen and Kari put together this amazing trip and how God has hands in so many things has just really helped me understand that I have to have patience and just understand that God is going to create this environment for all of us.
Hi, my name is Annika. I think the best part of the gathering was just seeing a bunch of Christian youth getting to worship Jesus together, and it was an absolute privilege to get to serve on the worship team.
Hi, my name is Gibson. My favorite part would probably be being able to play music and worship God.
My favorite part was probably hearing all the different speakers and their different stories.
My favorite part was the music and probably the diversity of the speakers.
So we actually had a group of about 16, is that what it was? 16 people that headed out from RLC and went up there. And this was an absolutely special and amazing week. So thank you to everyone for supporting these young people in things like this. It is so beautiful to see, and they are so awesome. I'm so proud of all of them for being so awesome. So thank you, and have a good day.
Okay, you're only going to get about a half a sermon from me today, because you got the other half already, that kind of thing. LCMC, Lutheran Congregations and Mission for Christ, our national church body, sponsors these summer events every 2 years. Well, they're at Grandview University in Des Moines, and they didn't have enough registrations come in to justify the cost of paying the staff, the cooking staff, cleaning staff, all that kind of stuff at Grandview, so they ended up pulling the plug on it. And Kari, a youth director in South Dakota, and Kristen, our own youth director, were like, no! That ain't gonna happen. We're gonna do something because we've already got our kids signed up and we've already done the fundraisers and things like that. And here's where the Holy Spirit kind of took over with some things. One of them was Ironwood Springs Camp, which is about an hour away. How many of you have ever seen Ironwood? You've been out there, that kind of thing, okay? They were available. That's just weird. For a summer camp to be available almost exactly the days that we needed them to be available. So that opening was there, and that's not that far from Des Moines, so people were already planning to come to Iowa or Minnesota anyway, so it worked out really well. And then the second thing is that the Dar family band, which we're going to have you guys back in a couple weeks sharing music, things like that, they made some quick adjustments to what they were doing, and they were like, okay, will be the band. Our praise team, RLC praise team, will be the band for that week and will provide the special music. So it really was kind of a neat thing to see how everything just kind of fell into place for this to happen. Okay, now I gotta preach. Alright. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Our text recorded in our epistle lesson, Paul's letter to the young pastor Timothy, 2 Timothy 2 verses 1 through 2. You then, my child, be strengthened by the grace that is in Christ Jesus, and what you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. In Jesus' name, amen. A couple of weeks back this summer, there was another pastor sitting in the pew. Another pastor sitting out there with you. I did not recognize him for reasons that will become clear. Following the second service, he came up and introduced himself. His name, Dennis Hayden. And yes, he is connected to the Hayden family here at RLC. He is Carrie Hayden's third cousin, once removed, brother's uncle, grandfather's nephew. I don't know. He's something like that. You know, he's related somehow. Now, the reason I did not recognize Dennis might have something to be with the fact that I have not seen him in over 40 years, literally. And Pastor Denny was kind enough not to assume that I would somehow remember him. Added to that, the fact that I was probably 17 the last time I saw him at my home church in Sioux City, Iowa. Denny was a vicar during my senior year of high school at my home church. Now, a vicar is an old school term for intern. And so as part of his seminary studies, Denny spent a year in Sioux City, Iowa, which kind of makes me wonder who he ticked off in the placement committee. Anyway, he was, and from what Carrie has told me, he's a good guy, still is. Freshly retired from the ministry up in Mankato, still filling pulpits when needed. Yeah, it's a small world and all that. But the reason I bring this up is that Denny, over 40 years ago, was one of a long line of people who had a strong influence in making me decide to be a pastor. Now, I don't believe in karma. I don't believe in coincidence. I believe we have a very, very intricate, providential God. Indeed, God the Holy Spirit is the master chess player at moving people to where he needs them to be. God uses people, including you and me, to create situations, to change situations, indeed to change other people, quite often without them having no clue that that's what God is doing with them. This summer's National Youth Event, which happened in Minnesota, oddly enough, is a great example of all that. The Holy Spirit, he's the only one who could have pulled off that kind of thing. And he does what he does quite quietly behind the scenes. Like the story of the Apostle Paul and the young pastor Timothy. In our epistle lesson, Paul is writing to a colleague. He's writing to a fellow pastor, but really, this pastor is his friend. It's a young pastor named Timothy, a friend who has personally helped Paul in his ministry, and a friend whom Paul is now trying to help. We have two of these letters in the Bible, 1st and 2nd Timothy. We have a third letter to a pastor named Titus. They're called the pastoral epistles, letters, and they're found toward the end of the New Testament. Once again, 2 Timothy 2, 1 through 2. You then, my child, be strengthened by the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And what you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. Now, Timothy's not a child, but Paul's affection, his love for this young pastor, has created this father-son bond between the two. Paul clearly loves Timothy. He wants Timothy to thrive, to succeed in ministry. But he knows that the boy is struggling, floundering even. And frankly, I suspect that Paul is worried that Timothy may not make it as a pastor. And so his first advice to the young pastor, and this is his second letter, is simply teach. To teach clearly, to teach the gospel clearly to other faithful men so that those men will then be equipped to teach others also. For you see, what we do here in church is primarily teach. I'm going to talk about that in a couple weeks a little bit more. And what we teach is primarily what has already been taught to us. For example, the Apostles' Creed. You ever wonder about that? Okay. That's simply the teachings that the apostles taught. And we keep teaching the same thing that the apostles taught. And we've been doing that for 2,000 years. Now, that also means that the church isn't a place where you're going to come and find a bunch of new ideas. In fact, if you're in a church and they have a bunch of new ideas, yeah, be careful. That's a problem. We don't need to be fresh. We don't need to be relevant. We don't need to be avant-garde. We don't need to be new and exciting. We need to keep telling the old, old story. And yeah, obviously that helps if we tell the story in good ways, in new and refreshing ways. We teach well, but we've always got to go back to teaching what has been taught to us, to teaching the gospel, to teaching the Bible. Now, the second thing that Paul reminds Timothy is that doing church, being a church, sometimes that can be tough. And that being a pastor, or being a youth director, or being an education director, or being a committee leader, or being a women's circle group leader, or serving on the church council, sometimes things can get tough. We here in church are at war, but we're not at war with one another, thank the Lord. I've actually served in congregations where I wondered if the congregation was at war with itself, if there were wars going on between the members. And yeah, that happens. There's other books in the Bible that deal with that. No, what we are at war with are the principalities and powers and ideas that are common in our world. These false ideas that constantly wage war against the truth of the gospel, that try to put Jesus down, that do not let the love of Christ flow. We need to understand that sometimes what we do here is not easy. Paul writes, 2 Timothy 2:3-7. Share in suffering as a good soldier of Christ Jesus. That's war talk. No soldier gets entangled in civilian pursuits, since his aim is to please the one who enlisted him. An athlete is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. It is the hard-working farmer who ought to have the first share of the crops. Think over what I say, for the Lord will give you understanding in everything. And that's the Apostle Paul. That's the way he usually does things. He uses three totally different illustrations to basically explain the same thing. A soldier, an athlete, a hard-working farmer. But the point is, each one of these tasks, none of them is easy, but they do what they do for the sake of the gospel. And then the third thing that Paul reminds young Pastor Timothy of, who it is that we as the church are fighting for. We know who we're fighting against, not each other. We're fighting against the principalities and powers of the world. But who are we fighting for? Who has enlisted us to serve? Who is our coach? 2 Timothy 2:8-9. Remember, Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, the offspring of David, as preached in my gospel, for which I am suffering, bound with chains as a criminal, but the word of God is not bound. We do what we do, always. We do what we do to remember Jesus, to talk about Jesus, to have opportunities to talk about Jesus. 80 people this summer went to a camp in southern Minnesota. And they spent an entire week, and the one thing they heard more often than not was Jesus. Amen? That's fantastic. They didn't go to sports camp and hear about Jesus. They didn't go to science camp and hear about Jesus. No, they just happened to go to a camp that was thrown together by a youth director in South Dakota and our own youth director, and they went and they heard about Jesus. Christ-centered. That is why we do what we do. 2 Timothy 2:10. Therefore I endure everything for the sake of the elect, that they also may obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. Now we just wanted to take an opportunity today to encourage our youth, to encourage our staff in what they are doing. Just as the Apostle Paul encouraged this young pastor Timothy, and just as the intern, the vicar, Dennis Hyden, once took a young student at the church he was at aside, and he said, "Hey, Steve, come here. I think maybe you should think about becoming a pastor. I think maybe you should go into the ministry." And that wasn't Dennis Hyden doing that. That was the Holy Spirit doing that. The Holy Spirit doing what only the Holy Spirit can do. Because you never know the plans the Lord has for you. In Jesus' name. We stand for prayer. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Guard your people, O Lord. Let not our hearts be empty of faith, nor our minds filled with pride. Give us a healthy respect for the things of old, which we have received from those who have gone before us, and give us a living faith that trusts not in works, but in Christ alone. Lord, in your mercy, give grace to your church that she be built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets and Christ the chief cornerstone, but also that she faithfully pass on the gospel to those to come. Bless all pastors and church workers in their vocations to serve us with your word. Lord, in your mercy, give grace to our young children and to the newly baptized that they diligently seek the instruction of your word, to grow in the knowledge of the Lord, and so become steadfast and immovable in the face of challenge or temptation. Lord, in your mercy, give grace to those afflicted in body and mind, so that they may rest their cares upon you and be kept strong in the day of trouble. We especially lift up Ethan Geiwitz, who will be undergoing heart surgery this coming week. We also remember those that we now name in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, in your hands, O Lord, we commit all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. But now thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you, I have called you by name, you are mine. Go in peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. We don't know this closing hymn that well. We do know the chorus really well. We're really good at that. But we're just going to kind of mumble our way through the verses, and hopefully we'll learn it a little bit better this coming year.